Hi there everybody, and welcome back to my channel, After Dark Coffee and Crime. And if you are a regular here, it's always good to see you back with me. And if you are new, hi and welcome. If you are here for the live chat, I love chatting with you in here. Just bear in mind, if I do put in a timestamp, that obviously that is for people that are watching after, so you may want to avert your eyes where the timestamp or warning appears. So in today's case, I'm going to be looking at the murder of Pc Andrew Harper, and he was also known by his friends and family fondly as Harps. As with all my videos, I like to give a content warning because of the nature of the cases, and with this one there are going to be discussions around the crime scene, and that might be distressing to some people, so viewer discretion is always advised. And obviously if it's something that you can't listen to right now, I obviously totally understand that, and please do switch off, and hopefully there's a podcast that you can watch back on replay, and we hope to see you on our next one. And again, as with all of my podcasts, I do like to just outline that the information that I do share here is information that I've searched for, researched on the internet. It could be from books, it could be from articles, in cases where there are discoveries or court transcripts that will come from there, and from any court hearings that I may have been watching, and usually they are very, very informative, and this is so that I can compile the most accurate account of what happened in the case, and to share the victim's story as factually as I can, and you know, just to give you the most reliable information, and it is for informational and educational purposes only. And so obviously there is no intention to cause any upset to anybody that may have, you know, experienced something similar in the cases that we talk about, or, you know people of any of the cases that we talk about, or to the family and friends, you know, who may come across this. So that's why I always ask you as well to remain respectful in the chat, because we never know who is watching. So who is Pc Andrew Harper? So Pc Harper, he was born on the 22nd of March in 1991, and he grew up in Wallingford, and he decided that he was going to become a police officer, and he started off with the Thames Valley Police as a special constable in 2010, and he was 19, and then he obviously went on to join the regular police force. And you know, joining the special constabulary is something that I have done in the past, and it really gives you an insight into the police, how the police work, and you know, how things are in place, and it just gives you an idea of whether the career is for you or not. And Lynn Jenkins, who was a head of a faculty who taught Pc Harper, said you know, he was a really hard-working student, he was conscientious, and he was always prepared to go the extra mile to get things wrong. And I think he was always willing to go the extra mile within his job, which is, you know, essentially how he ended up being the case that we are talking about today, because he did go the extra mile. And she went on to say that she remembered him at the age of 17 speaking about his passion for policing, and you know, even from a young age he was really clear that he'd made it clear to everyone that he wanted to be a police officer, and there was absolutely no plan B for Andrew Harper. It was all about becoming a police officer for him. He joined the Thames Valley's Police Road Policing Unit, and this was around 6 weeks before the incident that happened, and he was based at the Forces Abington Station. So in August, Pc Andrew Harper He was at this time he was 28 years old, and he'd not long been married to his new wife, Lissy Harper, and they were soon to be going on their honeymoon. They'd been married just 4 weeks, so just a month. And you know, she was the love of his life and vice versa, and they had actually had 13 years together prior to their marriage. And as I said, you know, they were looking forward to going away on their honeymoon and enjoying the rest of their lives together. And tragically, just the after these 4 weeks of marriage, PC Harper was on duty, and he was called to investigate a robbery, and unfortunately he never came home, and this is where his wife became a widow. And it was just the start of, you know, a long heartbreaking fight for justice for him. And so what happened? So on August the 15th, this is in the build-up to what happened, around 10 to 5, there were some individuals called Henry Long, Albert Bowers, Jesse Cole and Thomas King. And they had staked out a home, and the home was of Peter Wallace in Southend. And they had cased the property because he had a £10,000 quad bike on his property, and they were initially confronted by him and they did leave empty-handed, and in most cases, you know, that would have been it. You know, they'd have been, you know, most normal individuals would be you know, put off by that and wouldn't come back to the property, because clearly the homeowner was able to confront them. Like, he wasn't scared to, he confronted them, and so they left empty-handed. And on the same evening, at around 10 past 11 at night, they did actually return to Mr. Wallace's home, and they did try and steal the quad bike again. And he wanted to attach it to his Seat Toledo, so that they could tow it away. And Mr. Wallace was aware of, you know, them having arrived at their property, and so he makes a 999 call to report a theft in progress. And he, you know, explains to them he's got four masked men outside the house, and he thought that they had weapons. And so he goes into this, and I'm going to play the 999 call for you now so that you can get an idea. You know, the operator told him, you know, not to go outside, and obviously the guy was getting very agitated because they were taking his property. So have a listen to the 999 call, and then we will pick up thereafter.
Thames Valley Police, what's your emergency?
I've got four masked men outside my house, and they've got weapons. They came round earlier, and now they're in my they're at my property in Stamford.
And what
Dingley.
Weapons have they got?
Handheld things. They're all masked.
And what's your name?
Peter Wallace.
And your postcode?
RG76JP.
And what number are you?
I'm a Privet House. It's not a number. It's
Privet House.
Privet House. Yeah.
And what weapons did you say?
I saw them handheld things a moment ago. I don't know whether they're coming to break in this house. I don't know whether they're coming, but they're... Yeah, can you please send someone?
Are they trying to get into your property?
They are gone to break into something. They're trying to get into my garage or something.
Is that them I can hear in the background?
No, that's me shuffling about trying to see them.
And when did you see them before?
Well, I saw them before at 5 o'clock, but that's they come back in a different car, I presume.
And what do you think the weapons were?
Oh, just a handheld piece of wood or something. But I think they're just breaking into my garage to nick my stuff, eh? And they're both threatening outside. I presume they know I'm in here.
Can you get the registration number?
I've got GK53, I thought, but they came in another.
And when you said masks, are they? Masks? What do you mean? Are they faces covered?
They've got their faces covered, gloves on, hats on.
Are you at home alone?
Yeah. Oh, and they're stealing my squad bike. I'm going out there now.
No, don't go out there.
I'm going out there now.
No, because if they've got weapons.
No, I don't care. I've got to protect that bike. I'm taking the squad bike.
No, your safety is important. Stay in your property.
Please send someone. I'm going.
Someone's
out
on
there.
Their way. No, don't go out there.
Have you sent someone or not?
Officers are on their way. But you can't go out there.
I'm going.
If they've got a weapon, then you'll be hurt.
Well, there's all sorts of bits of wood out there. They could pick up anything, but they're not taking my van bike.
You need to stay in your property.
Taking it.
Does it have a registration number? Peter, does your bike have a registration number?
No, they tried to take the bike. They can't take it. They're going, I think.
Can you see their vehicle?
I don't know what they're doing. They've been a coming in around the car.
Can you still see them outside?
They've been inside into my property and around the. I don't know what they're doing.
Can you see what make and model the vehicle is?
No, it's GK53CYG. Yeah, they're backing in. They're backing into the property now. This is bad. They're going to try and come in here.
Are you able to get into a safe location, into a room?
No, not really.
Do you think they're trying to get into the vehicle to ram your property?
I don't know quite. I don't quite know. They tried to lift the bike and take the bike, and now they're pondering what to do. And I'll tell you what, that's not going to turn out well for me. I hope someone's on their way.
We've got several officers en route, okay? Are they still out there now?
No, they're coming back out. They're getting back out of the car. No,
when you saw them earlier, what were they doing?
I don't know. They jumped out of the car earlier in a different car. I presume it's the same people.
And what are they doing now?
They're just wondering what to do. I think because nothing's happened, they're going to come and try and.
And they're just standing around?
No, they're going back. I don't know what they're doing.
What, into your garage?
No, I can't quite see. I can't see any of them, and they're all out of the car.
And how many of them are there?
Three, four. I mean, they had spooked them, and they made up to just jump in the car and went to go, but then decided not.
We've got lots of units on their way, okay?
Yeah, they come from the top and the bottom of Stanford Dingley, they probably have them, there's nowhere to go, but. Yeah, they've changed their mind, they're going to have another go.
So they're going to your garage?
Oh, they're tow rope out. They're going to try and tow my car or something. I don't know what they're doing. Oh, they're dragging it up the road, they've got the bike out and they're dragging the.
What, the quad bike?
Yeah. They're
on their vehicle?
Yeah, they're dragging it up the road towards Tux Clump and.
Towards where?
Towards Tux Clump.
Doors?
Towards Tux Clump, Bradfield, South End. Right. Well, actually, I don't know if they've left my on both here or not. I don't know about it.
And what type of vehicle is it, Peter?
It's their one?
Yeah.
It's a silver car, silver hatchback. I couldn't see the make. And they're towing with a tow rope my quad bike by the handlebars around it.
Sorry, like I said, we've got several units.
Yeah, well, they go towards Bradfield or something like that. Oh, God, I should have gone out there.
No, no, Peter, don't. Your safety's important. I know it's your quad bike. And can you, have you lost sight of them?
Yeah, yeah, they've gone. They've gone up the hill, yeah.
Okay, your reference number is 1433.
Well, like I said, we've got several. It'll be a silent approach, okay? Just because we don't want to make them alarm them that we're on our way, okay?
Yeah, well, they've gone up the hill, so go towards Bradfield.
Is that a road or the area?
That's the village up the road from me. Bradfield South End.
Okay, I appreciate your direct... I don't know the area, so I'm relying on your... You know the area.
Yeah.
And did they take anything else, or is it just your quad bike?
I don't think they did. I think they just targeted it. I guess.
Did they break into the garage, or was it outside?
No, I presume they just wanted the quad bike. I don't know. I couldn't quite see. I presume they went towards the garage.
But the quad bike was outside.
Yes.
So were they outside your house earlier?
Yeah, a police car came down the road after it, not that long afterwards. Yeah. Presume that you were looking for them already. About 10 minutes later, a police car came down the bloody road. They obviously changed cars. See, earlier on they came in a car with the number plates taped up.
Mm.
Gone out there.
So we've got people out there looking for them now, okay? Perhaps they shouldn't be hard to miss if they're towing a quad bike.
Yeah, well, I don't know what they'd be doing. They're going towards the A4, no doubt.
Sorry, I'm just trying to read
while
I'm listening to you.
Is that the only way, or?
No. It's just a few words. I presume
I don't know which way they're going. Just want to keep you on the phone, okay? And you don't know if the quad bike's got a registration number?
Yes, it's got a registration number in theory. It's got a tracker, but I don't know where. I don't know how that works.
Do you know what the registration is for the quad bike?
Find it for you. I think it's RX19. It's a new one.
Because we might be able to, we've got the vehicle, but we can do some checks for the registration number for your quad bike as well.
That's right. You were going to make your way once
there's a tracker of some sort. I'm trying to find the info. It's on my phone, so I'll probably lose you if I try to find it. But that's okay.
Okay, so, all right.
Have you ever been targeted like this before?
No.
I know it's easier for me to say, but if they had weapons, we want you to have got hurt.
Well, I suppose if I say weapons, it could have been intended as a tool to get the bike off, you know, rather than a weapon, you know.
You just don't know who these people are or what they've got on them, you just...
No, my brother-in-law was working with me the other week, and he said that he found a big, stocky Romanian guy, Eastern European guy, around the back of the garage, and this guy was leading them then, was a big, stocky fella.
Mm.
So, I don't know if that's got anything to do with it. But I suspect so. Jesus Christ.
I know officers haven't come to you yet, Pete, but they are out there looking for it, okay? I can see,
So I try and find some sort of tracking number and call you back or something. I mean, is there a... Maybe, can I just...
Do you want me to give you this reference number?
Yeah, go ahead.
It's 1614.
1614.
And then it's today's date, so it's 15-08-19.
08-19.
Like I said, officers are out in the out looking for them, and as soon as one of the officers, they'll come and see you and speak about what's happened, okay? But they want to obviously get the suspects before they come and see you. If you see anything else, give us a call straight to 999.
Will do.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Someone will be in contact.
Okay. Nothing.
Thank you. No problem. Take care. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
And so, obviously, as we know with the dispatches, the 999 call comes through, or the 911, and the police are automatically dispatched. It doesn't slow the police showing up to the scene, and so they like to take details and as much information as they can. So they had dispatched police officers to the property, and that was PC Andrew Harper and PC Shaw, and this is to show the lengths that they would go to, and certainly PC Harper, that they were just finishing their shift, so they shouldn't have even been there, but they responded to the call. They were in an unmarked BMW because they were surveillancing, and instead of ending their shift, you know, they decided that they could do this and they would help out because they were out on the road anyway. So that's where it's really tragic, because, you know, 10-15 minutes later, maybe Andrew Harper would have been on his way home, but unfortunately, you know, he in the line of duty said that he would attend with PC Shaw. And so as they progressed, at around 28 minutes past 11 p.m, PC Shaw and PC Harper came across the Say at Toledo, and they had actually started towing the quad bike on Admore Lane near Bradford South End, and this is getting that first glimpse of, you know, the headlights that were approaching their car. So what happens then is the vehicles actually stop and they're facing each other and they're about 5 meters apart, and then seconds later Long mounts the verge as he tries to drive around the police car that PC Harper and PC Shaw are in, which is the BMW. Then PC Harper comes out of the car and one of the passengers runs, which is Cole, who runs past their police car, and they try and they've unhitched the quad bike, and then he tries to get back into the Sea at the back through the passenger window. And PC Harper and the unmarked police vehicle gives chase to the suspects, and PC Andrew Harper ends up, so he's actually not in the vehicle, and he's actually approaching, giving chase on foot, and he almost reaches the car. And what they hadn't seen, or so they say they hadn't seen, was that where they had unhitched the quad bike, PC Andrew Harper would not have seen the actual tow. It's not like a tow rope, it's like a tow strap. He did not see that, but the defendants knew that it was there. They knew that this loop was strapped to the car and it was being dragged behind the Sayer, and it was attached to the boot lid of the car. And so when PC Harper runs to the, you know, to catch them up, he then gets caught in that loop strap, and this loop strap then twists onto his foot and boot, and in doing so he then can't free himself, and he was caught in the strap that had been initially there to tow the quad bike, and he was then dragged. And Long is the driver of the vehicle, and he accelerates off with PC Harper attached to the loop, and they drag PC Harper for more than a mile along a winding country road. And if you have a look up the on the picture there, you can see the map of where PC Harper would have been caught and to how far he was dragged to. And as I said, the ankle there got caught in, you know, his boot, and got caught in that rope, and he could, you know, he wasn't able to free himself. And the court were told how Long continued to drive, and he drove at great speed along the country lanes, and he was also described as having swung the car, so like in a zigzag, to try and dislodge PC Harper. Now, whether he knew that was PC Harper or whether he thought he'd caught something else remains up for discussion, because his attorneys would argue that that wasn't the case, they didn't know that it was him. But they were driving at such speed, and actually in one of the research things that I came across when I was watching, I learned that the actual police officers did a reenactment of the drive, and they tried to drive at the speed that Long and the gang were in the car, at the speed that that car was going, and even professional drivers couldn't do that because it was dangerous, so they couldn't match the speed. So they were driving down those country lanes at such a speed, and obviously, you know, PC Harper was being dragged all the way along, and PC Shaw realizes very quickly that something isn't right, because he no longer can see his colleague. So he turns the car around because he wants to go and look for PC Harper, and it is said that some eyewitnesses say that they saw the Sayer was towing something, and it was that bad, it looked like the carcass of a bloody deer.
there's a body in the road, just fell out of the vehicle. Can't be going with the body. Before that's currently Pc Harper. I just found it stabbed there in the road.
But they soon began to realise that it was actually a person trapped, and he had both of his ankles that were entangled into the tow rope. So, you know, and he had been thrown around the road. He'd been sort of striking up the sides there. And as PC Shaw is following or trying to find PC Harper, he then starts to see stuff scattered in the road, and when he stops his car, he comes out and he discovers PC Harper's vest, as you can see up in this video here. Have a look and just see, you know, how shredded that vest is. I'm going to just play that section for you now.
3-4, my colleague PC Harper got out of the vehicle, ran after the vehicle. I've now lost him.
Clue location.
The vehicle will come out. On the A4, just down from Sully.
Hey, sir, I'll be where I am at Austin. I'm waiting for it to start five. Kenzie, if it comes out, you go one. Hey, get mate.
You know, the vest ended up being in two parts in the road, and as he follows the route, he then sees more debris that belongs to PC Harper, like his ID badge and things like that, scattered out there in the road. And he, it's said that his uniform was literally ripped off his body as he was being dragged along, and just the thought of that makes my skin crawl, because I can't imagine what that would feel like to be dragged at that speed, you know, to rip his, you know, stab vest off, his clothes off, all bar his shoes, because obviously they are entangled in the tow rope. But PC Shaw, you know, he is recovering bits that he can. And at approximately 11:30 p.m., so not long after Chase was given, PC Bushnell comes across PC Harper's body, and they said that he had been dragged for just over a mile. PC Bushnell alerts his colleague, PC Andy Kemp, that there's a figure in the road, and they set off in pursuit of the Sayat. And PC Shaw reaches the A4, and that's on the corner or near Upton Lane, and he finds his colleague having followed a trail of blood and body matter leading up to PC Harper's body. And meanwhile, Long, who's giving no care in the world, he is continuing his journey, and he gets stuck behind a wedding coach and turns back, and this forces PC Bushnell to take action to avoid a head-on collision, because it's the Sayat is driven at speed back towards the Four Houses corner, which is where they try to take the quad bike from, which is right near the Four Houses corner, which is where the traveller site is, and that's near where the house was, where the quad bike was tried to, or attempted to be stolen from. And as we know, the 999 dispatchers, 911 dispatchers, they multitask, and so that when they get the calls coming in, they dispatch the police, they dispatch ambulances, all sorts of things going on while the 999 call is taking place. And at this point, the National Police Air Service helicopter is directed towards the traveller's site, and the helicopter reports seeing a very, very hot something in the road near the site, and they can also see people standing around another car in the area. PC Harper, as we know, eventually became disentangled, and when they got there, sadly, there was nothing that they could do, and so at 23:45 p.m. on August the 15th, 2019, PC Harper was pronounced dead, and he was just 28 years old, all over a quad bike, a man who shouldn't have been there. He should have been going home. You know, a man with a lot to live for and a lot to look forward to, gone, and the whole incident takes around 30 seconds.
I'm arresting both of you on suspicion of murder, all right, and that's of a Thames Valley police officer. So it's suspicion of murder of a Thames Valley police officer.
Does it look like I've done a murder?
The
autopsy gave Harper's cause of death as being a result of multiple injuries, and it's congruent with the theory that he'd been caught between a vehicle and the road, and he had been dragged for a long distance. And what the post-mortem showed actually was, even though there is no grace of anything about this, that he had sustained a very severe brain injury on hitting the floor when he was pulled and towed. And so the pathologist said that it is likely that PC Harper lost consciousness immediately when he fell to the ground, which means that he would not have been aware of the pain and everything else that he would have been he would have endured had he not have been knocked unconscious. And they said that the defendants were driving at approximately 42.5 miles per hour, and the court heard that, you know, it did render him unconscious immediately, and it prevented him feeling the pain from being dragged. But it was tragic, and it was very upsetting and disturbing for his colleagues to come and witness him, because he was found literally naked with none of his clothes, because they'd been ripped off, and all he had was his boots on, which were caught in the tow loop. And you know, his body was pretty unrecognisable, and they did try to resuscitate him, but, you know, they weren't able to, and so the paramedics then obviously called his death at the scene. So there was nothing more they could do. So who are the suspects? Henry Long, who was 19 at the time of the crime, he was actually the ringleader of the gang, and his accomplices were Albert Bowers and Jesse Cole, and they were both 18, so a little bit younger, but not much younger. And they admitted to the manslaughter of PC Harper. Now, in the initial investigations, because they were not honest and, you know, they were lying, the police investigation came into the traveller's site, and they actually took 10 males from the site and arrested and questioned them because they weren't, you know, getting any information. They were all kind of sticking together, and they were questioned, and they had their phones seized as well, so that they could obviously get any records from them. And they locked the campsite down, or the traveller site down, and the ages of the people that were arrested were from the age of 13 through to 30 years of age, and they were obviously taken for interview into the investigation to find out what had gone on. And you know, as with a lot of criminals, especially, you know, if they're in that sort of traveller site, they are going to, you know, stick together, and they don't throw each other under the bus. It's just not done in that kind of community. And on the 19th of August, a man called Jed Foster, who was just 20, was charged with murder and the theft of the quad bike. But it was later found that he wasn't part of the incident that happened, and so therefore he was released. Going into September, the 18th, the police have managed to analyse the phone data, and this phone data places Long, Cole and Bowers at the scene. And this is where I said Jed Foster was then ruled out, despite, you know, there was suggestion that he could have been involved in the first instance. And Long and Cole Bowers were charged with murder, and the coroner actually gave the verdict that PC Harper's death was by homicide as a result of dragging. And on September the 19th, as I said, Jed Foster's charges were dropped. As you can see, these things don't, you know, they're not rushed. And on October the 14th, so a little while after, here in the UK, when people pass away, you know, it can take a while anyway to, you know, bury them and have a funeral. But where there's an investigation, it can take longer. And sometimes, you know, funerals can be delayed years. If the investigation is ongoing and, you know, they haven't closed the case. So poor PC Harper wasn't able to be laid to rest until the 14th of October. And he had a funeral at Christchurch Cathedral in Oxford, and he had a massive turnout. The whole city came to a standstill to honour PC Harper. There were thousands of bikers, and obviously Lissy, PC Harper's wife, was also there and took part in a ride to respect his memory. A little bit sort of later on, as the time is passing, on the 13th of March, the court heard that all parties agreed that the police constable, who was the first to attend on the A4, did not strike their vehicle, which was what was initially reported. So that was quashed. And then, unfortunately, as we know, we had COVID, so they ended up having to halt the trial because one of the jury was unwell, and then another two jurors were discharged because they were self-isolating. And so with the COVID pandemic, things, you know, did get affected in how quickly things were then progressed. On the 23rd of March, along with every other jury trial in England and Wales, the trial was suspended, and this was pending reviews because of the spread of COVID, and whether trials were going to be in person or whether they were going to be by Zoom, and, you know, that just trying to manage the COVID pandemic, because it was new to everyone. So all the trials were suspended, and it didn't pick up until a bit later, which was from the 23rd of June. Now, also in this, we had a little bit of drama, it seems, in a UK court. Now, we don't get to see the same as we do as the American courts. So with America, you get to watch the court and the trial play out, but in England, you don't. Although now you do get the sentencing, which is a new thing. And hopefully one day we will be able to see what goes on in the courtrooms in England. However, during this trial, one of the jurors ended up being suspended, and that was because the juror had been reported by a prison officer saying that she had mouthed "bye boys" to the defendants in the courtroom, which is obviously going to get you removed from the jury because there's a bias there. And there had also been reports of intimidation of the jury, which is obviously illegal as well. So Henry Long, at the time, who was 19, admitted to PC Harper's manslaughter but not murder, and Albert Boas and Jesse Cole, who were both 18, they were convicted of manslaughter at the trial of the Old Bailey, and they were given 13-year-old sentences. And Henry Long was also convicted of manslaughter, not murder, and he was given 16 years in prison. Now, in the court, it was said that none of the suspects were intelligent. None of them had any real education, and their parents had taken them out of school at a very young age. And Bowers and Cole were said to suffer from serious learning difficulties, although they managed to work for their dads. Long is described as being a bit brighter, but in his life he'd sort of chosen the life of crime. He was a thief, and he was in charge of them that night, and he was the one giving them the order. So if you're someone with learning difficulties, you know, it's going to be easy to manipulate and take advantage of people that aren't so clever, aren't so bright, and aren't so aware that are vulnerable. So you do have to bear that in mind. However, it doesn't justify, you know, what happened. I mean, they weren't driving the car. Henry Long was driving the car. And so during the hearing, you know, they did say, like, you know, despite their learning difficulties, you know, they were able to understand that what was happening was wrong, and yet they still chose to participate in that. And although they were passengers, Bowers was in the car as a passenger when PC Harper was killed, as was Cole. The defense argued during the trial that they couldn't have possibly have intended that to happen to PC Harper, and the defense tried to claim it was an actual freak event, and that not one of them, including Long, could, you know, actually prepare for that and planned that or foreseen that, and therefore said that it was an unfortunate accident. But the prosecution had argued the point that, you know, PC Harper was 6 foot, he weighed 14 stone, and the defendants must have been aware that PC Harper was being dragged to his death, and they didn't stop. He continued. In fact, he was playing music. It was said, as I said before, that they were zigzagging in the road, and they must have known that they were dragging somebody behind it. And there's no evidence to suggest that Bowers and Cole even attempted to persuade Long to stop the vehicle, as it was reaching average speeds of 42.5 miles per hour. And you can tell the contempt and the lack of remorse in these lads, because during the trial, Bowers was seen falling asleep as the prosecutor showed footage of Harper's ordeal, and the judge stated that she didn't believe any of them show any remorse. Cole was pictured smirking and laughing along with his friends as they arrived to court. You can see in the pictures, and you know, when you see those pictures, you can see that they're laughing and that there is no remorse on their behalf. So they, you know, they admitted to the conspiracy to steal the quad bike and to manslaughter, but there was no remorse. And they didn't want to be convicted of murder, because obviously that carries a heavier sentence. So at each point there was just no remorse, and you know, trying to save their own bacon and not even any concern or whatever to the families of PC Harper, and I think probably to them, because it was a police officer and they are from the travel site, and they're in that travel community. Often the traveling communities can have feelings against the police. I know certainly where I came from that, you know, police officers, if they were going into the traveler community park where their homes would be, that they wouldn't go in just as a two, that they would go in as a four, so that there was more than two police officers and one vehicle on the traveller's site. And you know, not all travellers are bad, not at all. They are hard working, most of them. I've seen them with my own eyes, like when a neighbour of mine was having some work done. The people that came to do the work were from the travelling community, and they worked super hard. You know, they keep their homes immaculate. You know, the women like to look good for their husbands, and they take care of their children, but they will stick together and they will look after each other, and that's just because it's a community to them. But obviously it doesn't make any of this right what happened to them. And you know, traveling communities do have a bad reputation, and it is things like this incident that contributes to the travelling community having a bad reputation for stealing and that kind of thing. But it's not true for the entire travelling community, because as I said, for the majority they work hard and they look after their own, and they look after their wives, and their wives look after them and their children, and they are positive. So you know, it's just unfortunate that things like this obviously bring it into the light, and you do see the bad side to the community. And it's always the bad side that sticks in anything that you look at. You know, if something isn't a good thing, you know, people remember that and they don't look at the good stuff. So I just wanted to be clear about that, in terms of, you know, the traveling community as a whole. You know, they shouldn't be tarred with the same brush, because for a lot of them, you know, they are good people. So after, you know, a long period of time of cancellations of trials and COVID and everything else, on the 31st of July, Long was sentenced to 16 years, as I said earlier, and Bowers and Cole both got 13 years in prison, and this was for manslaughter. And as with all cases, you know, the jury have asked if there's any pressure from any of the other jurors and things like that when they make their deliberations and come in and obviously give their verdict. And you know, the foreperson is always asked, you know, whether their accounts are true for each juror in the room, and each juror can also be asked if their vote is their vote. And you know, just to clarify that everything is above board and there's no pressure from other jurors. And as we know, as part of the trial process, we hear victim impact statements, and Lissy Harper gave her impact statement, because obviously as his wife this greatly affected her, and this is what she had to say. So she said, "This is my third attempt at writing a statement. I simply find myself at a loss and in an endless world. That's the reason in particular this question defeats me, and unless you have stood in my shoes, lost a soulmate, a beloved partner that you intended to spend the rest of your life with, how is grief possible to describe? I've used every word possible to describe this torture. It's an indescribable trauma, and I've been forced to endure a horrendous 11 months. I've cried and I've just broken down." And she also said, "My husband was brutally killed just 4 weeks after our wedding day. And should I speak again of how we were robbed of our future, our plans, they were stolen from us. For 4 weeks was all I had with my husband to be able to be called his wife. And my life feels bleak, hopeless and irreparable. And every aspect of my life since Andrew was taken is bitterly different." She also said that not only did the teenagers take away her husband, they took their future, and they took more than one life that day. They stole the person that she used to be. Every ounce of beautiful peace gone. And in answer to the question, "How has Andrew's death impacted me?" she says, "You can be satisfied. I am now a shadow of the person that I once was. I'm broken, distraught, beaten, and there's a void and an empty shell. And he gave everything, and Andrew will never grace us with his smile and his compassion and selfless generosity. And I will spend every day for the rest of my life with that hole that will never be filled. And I search around for the words to express my heartbreak, but each word is inadequate." And, you know, that will have been taken into account when the judge was doing her sentencing. And there is on the judicial website the information for the full information on the judge's remarks, but I'm going with the partial because it kind of sums that up. But there is a bigger document online if you wanted to read the full thing. But the at sentencing, obviously we know what their terms are, but the judge gives this remark, and she says, "You know, nothing which I can do or could have done if there had been a conviction for murder can restore Andrew Harper to his loving wife and family, or to the public he served so well. His devastating loss in these terrible circumstances will follow his family forever, and they have the profound sympathy of the court and the whole nation in their loss. The victim's personal statements are deeply moving, and I have read them with care, and I have listened intently to what was said in the courtroom. I heard the trial and the facts, and I set out below the information of which I'm sure, having heard the evidence, the jury were not that sure that Henry Long knew that he was driving from Admiral Lane to Ufton Lane with the car dragging a human body. That was what the prosecution had to prove. So before anyone could be convicted of murder, they did not succeed in doing that. And I think that's because obviously there is that gap of question of, did they know that they were dragging PC Harper or didn't they? These young men therefore fall to be sentenced for manslaughter, which we know has a lesser charge, and cases of manslaughter do range greatly in seriousness. Sometimes death may be caused by an act of gross carelessness. Sometimes a case of manslaughter may be close to a case of murder in its seriousness, and that is so here. And this is a very serious case of manslaughter. So the judge obviously then took that to the higher end of the manslaughter charge. And obviously they were then handed their sentences, and as I said, if you want the full document, you can go and find that is out there for you to see. But obviously this was not the news that PC Harper's colleagues and his wife and family wanted to hear. They did not feel it was justice, and Lissy Harper was described as being outraged by the outcome. And following the trial, she launched a campaign for the killers of emergency workers to face mandatory life sentences, and she fought for there to be a review. She wrote to the Prime Minister and she fought for Harper's Law, and this law, she wanted to have it so that criminals who were convicted of killing a police officer, firefighter, nurse, doctor, you know, prison officer, paramedic, anyone that is in the emergency services, be jailed for life. No ifs, no buts. And she wanted this to, you know, for PC Harper's life to not be in vain, the loss that they had. And she said that the campaign, backed by the Police Federation as well, it will help fix the broken justice system, you know, and it isn't going to change things for her, but going forward it could make a difference to other people and their families. And she is seen, I've got pictures, as you can see, you know, she meets with the Prime Minister, and she had written him an open letter which she publicly posted on Facebook. And she wrote to Boris Johnson, because initially she, you know, she wanted the case to be looked at again. She wanted a retrial because she felt, you know, that Andrew hadn't got justice for his death in the line of duty. And so her initial aim was to see if she could have a retrial. And she wrote, if there is the slightest chance that injustice can be rectified, then I'm going to do everything I can to ensure that it is. And she asked them to hear her words, see the facts that are laid out before them, and she asked with no expectation other than hope that she might be able to help towards make these changes and have them considered to ensure that Andrew was given the retrial that he unquestionably deserves, because they wanted to see that the justice system had a solid ethical foundation, and not the joke, that's how she described it, that they saw it as it was now, because obviously she felt very much so that justice had not been served. But despite her pleas, the Prime Minister doesn't have the power to order retrials in a court. And the Crown Prosecution Service stated that the decision to seek retrial depends on the public interest, and only cases involving significant public interest factors in favour of a retrial. Responding to her letter, the Prime Minister's spokesperson said that the thoughts are with the family and friends and the colleagues of PC Harper, and, you know, they have every sympathy for their loss. And they talk about the bravery that PC Harper showed in intercepting the criminals, and it was a stark reminder of the danger that they put themselves in every day. And the Prime Minister was said that he was going to respond to Mrs. Harper's letter formally once legal proceedings had been concluded. And although she, you know, knew that the changes wouldn't make a difference for Andrew, she continued to fight so that no other families and colleagues and friends do not ever go through, obviously, what she's been through and what his colleagues and their friends have been through. And she did succeed in the fight for Harper's Law, and this was passed in November on the 24th in 2021, and it's going to be incorporated into in existing police crime sentences, but it doesn't act retrospectively, which is why I was explaining that it won't obviously change things for her and it won't get her the retrial. But the purpose of the law, brought about by the efforts of Lissy, makes the killing of an emergency service worker in the course of duty punishable with a mandatory life sentence if convicted, with a minimum term set by the judge, and this must be served before eligibility for parole or release, and only in certain exceptional circumstances, depending on the offence itself or the offender, will a lesser sentence be considered. Since obviously fighting for Harper's Law, you know, Lissy has said that, you know, her husband was robbed of his life and they were robbed of their future together, and you know that nothing is going to change that, that the law won't change the outcome for his killers, but no longer will anyone else endure the pain and injustice of the court as she has all those months ago. And that is in itself a significantly powerful outcome. Following the success in Harper's Law, she said that she intends to move forward and effectively retire from the public life that she's seen, because obviously she's been very present in fighting for Harper's Law. And in moving forwards, she says that she does want to find happiness again. And she says that Andrew would want her to move on and find happiness, and that she felt very much that he was watching over her and that he would be proud of her and for obviously fighting for Harper's Law. And she said if it was the other way round, she would want Andrew to also find happiness moving forwards. Such an, you know, all these cases are tragic. This one, it just, when I, you know, read and saw what happened to, you know, PC Harper's body, and trying to picture how, you know, frightened he was, and you know the kind of pain that he would have been in, there was that reassurance that he will have been completely unconscious and he wouldn't have felt any of that. And it doesn't make the case any less horrific. The case is horrible. All cases are horrible. But this is tragic. And, you know, we wish nothing but the best for Lissy in her future. And I hope that she is able to move forward and find happiness. And although she'll never get over losing her husband, she will hopefully have the strength and find happiness going forward. And that PC Harper's friends and other family members are able to move on, knowing that Harper's Law is in place and that his name isn't lost in vain through the loss of his life in these tragic circumstances. As with all my videos, as I come to the end, I do like to pop an image of the person. So I like to close this podcast with an image of PC Harper, who lost his life in the line of duty, so that we can give a moment to think of him, everything that he did for his community, think of his family, think of Lissy, and may he rest in peace. That's all for today's podcast, and I look forward to seeing you on the next one. Bye for now. Bye.